This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
Welcome to Unlocked, IGN's Xbox show. I don't remember how Ryan introduces the show. It's a disaster episode because Destin gets the host. But today I am very excited to welcome my co-hosts, Parris Lilly and Brad Sams. Thank you both for joining me today. I am stoked about today's episode. Parris, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. You said disaster, so here I am. So let's do it. I'm looking forward to it.
You guys will carry it. Brad, how are you doing today?
No complaints, master of disaster on this end, ready to dive into Xbox.
So to start, I want to talk about the Fallout TV show because there's a lot of buzz about it right now. Brad, you haven't seen it. Parris and I have seen it. So we'll go to you first. And without me attempting to influence your take, what is your temperature level for this? Are you just like not into it? Are you a little excited? How are you feeling?
Ooh, I think the initial reviews that came out, which is a terrible way to start a TV series or anything, honestly, in general, I like to go in kind of blind, look fantastic. So I'm curious to see what you guys say, because from the cover and the outside influences, it looks like they've got a winner on there.
Got it. Well, what about you personally, though? Are you going to check it out?
I'll definitely check it out. It's more of the living the dad life, right? So you take your time. That. And when you get it, so it's most likely going to be consumed this week.
Yeah, I did it in the dead of night. Parris, what about you?
I loved it. I was fortunate enough that I got to see the entire series ahead of time, and it's fantastic. It really captures the feel of Fallout, what you would expect from the satire, obviously the music of the time, the violence and the gore as well. And I think there is a pretty interesting story in there that they're telling, and I won't obviously go into spoilers or anything, but there's definitely some twists and some surprises in there that I think fans are going to really enjoy.
I am a big Fallout fan, and this show knocked my socks off. Yeah. I went in with low expectations. I honestly think it is probably the best video game adaptation to date. I can't think of anything that comes close to it besides The Last of Us HBO series, which I also really liked. I think this is better than the Fallout or The Last of Us series by like a little bit. It's just so good. It just hit all the right notes for me. And like I was like, yeah, OK, I got these screeners. I guess I'll finally check it out. I watched one episode and I couldn't stop. I watched basically until I'm like, I have to go to bed. It's like 3 a.m. I got to go to sleep. And then I finished it out the next day, the last two. So it got its hooks in me that good. It hits all of the right notes for me. And I am stoked to see the reaction online. Parris, any other thoughts about the show?
Just the cast that they were able to put together. I mean, Walton Goggins, I mean, he's obviously legendary, but him as the ghoul is just... I'm just the standout. Also, Lucy, who is basically like the main character. She's like our introduction into this world of Fallout, especially for new people that aren't familiar. Fantastic as well. But I mean, Michael Emerson's in there. I mean, there's just so many great actors that they have in the show. And again, there's a few surprises as well. And, you know, people that might like Dune. Was it Kyle McPherson? I believe I'm saying his name right. He's in this as well. You'll see. I definitely want people to check this out. Don't let it get spoiled for you. And to your point, Destin, I put this right up there with The Last of Us as far as a video game adaptation into a television series. Very well done. Really well done.
Well, we don't want to go into too much detail. Leave your comment below the episode and let us know what your thoughts were about the TV series. Because if you're watching this, maybe you've watched a few episodes the night it came out. But I can't sing its praises enough. I think it's fantastic. And I'm very excited to see everybody talk about it. Brad, a story a little bit more up your alley. We are going to jump down to how it feels like Xbox is apparently full speed ahead on next-gen hardware. That was via Windows Central, who leaked some internal emails that Sarah Bond had sent to the team. On the next-gen front, and it's very notable that they say next-gen and not like a pro or anything like that, What can you tell us about what you've heard, what you might know via the FTC documentation about what this next gen initiative could be from Microsoft?
Well, okay. I think it's kind of like important to put this into perspective, if you will. So we know that Microsoft did, lack of better terms, a quote unquote pro last generation, right? The Xbox One Series X came out kind of mid-cycle, up things a little bit. And I'm a real big data guy. So my gut from this, because I, much like you, I was like, well, they didn't say pro. They said next gen, which means, you know, whole new launch cycle, Xbox Series, something not X, pro or whatever. So my brain goes, why wouldn't they do that? Because clearly they can look at what Sony's doing. Like we've all seen the, like we've all seen the rumors. We know that Sony's probably going to do a pro, right? They've done a pro before. Does Microsoft want to be left out in the cold? My brain immediately thinks they looked at their data from when they launched the Xbox One Series X, that mid-cycle regen, and they probably sat down in a boardroom and said, did this do anything for us in a positive manner? Did we grow? Did the Xbox gamer base grow? Like, did it notably get bigger? Because remember, they keep saying, we want more subscribers. We don't want more hardware sales. And so if they looked at that and said, look, the Series X or the One X only sold to existing customers who already had an Xbox One, if we do a pro, we're going to deviate from our mission of trying to grow the base. We're just going to resell hardware at a risk to our own customer base. We're not going to grow what Xbox is. And so that's why I think maybe we're starting to hear them say, look, we're not going to do it. We've seen the, I think, the digital white version, the Xbox Series X without a disc, likely coming this fall, according to the rumors. And so I think that they have a strategy and they're like, look, Sony's going to do what it's going to do, but we already know that's not going to make a difference. They're just going to sell the Pro to PlayStation 5 customers, and that's the it. And that's it.
Well, so, I'm going to come back to you in just a second, because there are still handheld rumors and there are rumors of a mid-gen refresh. We'll come back to that one second. First, I want to hear from Parris Lilly. Parris, what's your take on Sarah Bond talking about how they're basically all in, going really big with their next-gen hardware, and just general thoughts about the topic?
You know, I think Brad actually put it into perfect terms on kind of how I'm thinking about it, because when I think of just as myself as a consumer looking at last generation, I got a 1X when it came out. And when I look back and think, did it really do anything for me in that Xbox One generation? Not really. I mean, it was more of a push into 4K, if anything, but we're already in 4K in this generation. We might see some games get some frame rate improvements. But beyond that, I don't feel like I need a mid-gen refresh right now. So to the point of everything that Brad is saying, Xbox's strategy has been, we already have our console hardware base. We already have those customers. We're trying to reach more people. We're trying to get our games on more screens and get more people to invest into our ecosystem. So adding a mid-gen refresh right now isn't going to grow that. If anything, deliver the games that we obviously have already seen announced, and we know they have 30 plus studios at this point, continue putting out quality games, continue making Game Pass more desirable for people to actually want to invest in, show off the cloud strategy, get more of these games out, get people that aren't ready in your ecosystem that may not necessarily want to go buy an Xbox to actually say, hey, I want to play these Xbox games. Ooh, here's a great subscription service that I can subscribe to. Oh, I can cloud stream it onto my TV, things like that. And obviously, day one on PC, they already have. So, yeah, I think the smart move was to, like, let's just see this generation out as is, as from a hardware standpoint, and invest in whatever the next generation is going to be. Because I'll even say, as I wrap this up, when I think about everything that we've seen since the start of this generation, COVID, all the delays, everything, I almost feel like this generation hasn't even really started to the point where I feel like I need new hardware, you know, to experience these games.
Well, let me throw a wrench into your theories, because we do know that during the official podcast, they said they have hardware that they're going to be discussing this fall. So there's rumors that there is an Xbox handheld on the way. They have discussed something in terms of hardware. I am very excited about the idea of an Xbox handheld with the success of the Steam Deck. The Steam Deck has sold around, I believe, 4 million units was the guesstimate that we've seen from a few analysts. The official is multiple millions. That is the line from Valve. But when you look at where Xbox is going, I like the idea of innovating with a handheld. Brad, what are your thoughts on a handheld or whatever they're discussing this fall?
Yeah, I don't know if we'd see a handheld this fall. However, I'm a little bit different on the spectrum here when it comes to the handheld, primarily because, and Phil Spencer started to talk about this, which I think was really informative to like kind of think, because again, if Phil Spencer's talking about something, I think we all agree that there's a good probability it's going to happen one way or another, or at least they're considering it, is from a hardware perspective, what could Microsoft do different that would be better than, say, the ROG Ally or any of these other handhelds that already are out there? I think the missing component is the software side. And I think that's what Phil Spencer was hinting at. He's like, hey, these pieces of hardware are fantastic. We all buy chips from the same suppliers. It's all RAM, it's all storage and an LCD. What could Xbox do different? Well, that's the software side, where I think that we could see some better innovation come from Xbox that either A, lifts up these existing devices and reduces Microsoft's risks, or really just builds out like an Xbox handheld certified ecosystem that really makes a lot more sense. That's kind of my take on it.
You know what? I actually think that's a really smart angle to come at this from, because let's say they do the Windows Lite or whatever piece of software that's right in Microsoft's wheelhouse. Obviously, they develop Windows, right? They have tablets. What if they can make something that's a little bit more open, a little bit easier for a gamer to install Steam, to install Epic Game Store, et cetera, on this device? And could that be more widely adapted? Currently, I took my Steam Deck and I installed Windows on it, but obviously, you know, Windows 10 is pretty hefty to put on a device like that. Parris, what are your thoughts on the idea that they could be making some sort of light Windows OS that would be a little bit more open and accessible, allowing you to customize your hardware to your heart's desire?
So I agree with what both of you are saying as far as the software standpoint goes on that. And I think as Phil was talking about, it's just making it more ease of use, making it replicate more of the Xbox experience on these handhelds. I have the Rogue Ally, I have a Steam Deck, and the biggest pain point that I have with the Rogue Ally is the initial setup, kind of getting everything working the way I want it to work, because it is essentially just Windows 11, you know, on a handheld. So a more curated software experience, a more curated UI experience would be ideal. Now, the other part I'll put on in this, I viewed what he was talking about as more of a two-tiered approach, whereas, yes, we will still work with these third-party manufacturers like Asus's, the MSIs of the world, you know, to give a more curated experience on their handhelds. But I also see Microsoft or Xbox having their own handheld, which can more succinctly replicate the console experience. I think of the Switch as kind of the template here, where it's a hybrid, where it is a handheld on the go. You can also dock it to your television. But I think the advantage that Microsoft could have, or Xbox could have, over these third-party handhelds is their PC Game Pass. They're not the entire Xbox library. Whereas if it is truly running an Xbox OS and, you know, you have the hardware specs locked in, that now I can access my entire Xbox library, not only my first party stuff that I find on PC, but also the third party games that I may not own on PC, but I do own them in my Xbox digital library. Plus the backwards compatibility standpoint of this, when I think about the 360 era and those games that you would have access to, now you have access to those on a handheld as well. So I see both sides. I could see Xbox completely leaning into what you were talking about, where it's like, let's just make on the Windows a Windows Lite. You can install that. You can install Steam. You can do everything. Or they could full on say, we're truly giving you an Xbox handheld that gives you everything that we have in our ecosystem and not just a PC experience.
I hear that. The full quote is, we are moving full speed ahead on our next generation hardware, focused on delivering the biggest technological leap ever in a generation. So when do you think the actual announcement about this new hardware comes? And when do you think the handheld, if that's a thing, announcement hits? Paris?
Oh, you asked me. So I've thought a lot about the handheld, that if they were doing a handheld, it either needs to happen this holiday, if we're talking this generation, or you just wait till next gen, which I think the rumors have been holiday 2026, because it wouldn't make sense to try and drop something in 2025. And then the very next year you're going, oh, we're going next gen. Now that handheld would be a generation behind. I think my personal opinion on this holiday announcement is, sure, you're probably going to get that all digital Series X, and maybe they announce whatever the next generation is going to be to kind of give a tease towards it. But I personally don't think we get the handheld this year, but that would be a great.
Microsoft has lost literal billion, tens of billions of dollars trying to get into the handheld space, right? We all know about Windows Phone. This thing has come and gone. The Surface Duo has come and gone. Microsoft's tried to crack this nut for a long time in various means. I'm not saying that Xbox would go down the same route, but I imagine Phil Spencer walking into the boardroom and saying, hey guys, I need all this money because I'm going to go build a handheld. And to me, that's a hard argument to win. Someone's going to say Brad's just anti-handheld. It's definitely not that, but it's more so like when I think of Microsoft, I think of like where they have truly innovated. It's been on that software side at the end of the day. Like Xbox Live was so far ahead of everybody else. Even the ability today, like your friends jump on, you get that little invite, the pop-up happens, you hit the button, and you jump right into their game. Like to me, if Microsoft is going to do this, I don't think we see it this year. I think it would be definitely a next year, but I think Parris's point is really interesting because there's other questions about this. So let's say they do a handheld. Is it running the PC version of the games, or is it truly running an Xbox version of the game? If it's running the Xbox version of the game, that changes the narrative a little bit. One, like what type of CPU's in there, for one thing. And so, like, I think we first need to understand, like, what games is it running? If it's running true Xbox games, then I think it might actually lag behind their next generation stuff, because we all understand how CPUs work, right? You get the latest and greatest, it runs hot, right? Mm-hmm. But if you're going to put it in a handheld, you can't run it hot. So it might be actually a generation behind, which potentially mean a next year release might make a little bit more sense from a logical perspective, potentially.
Well, we will see. Yep. What if instead of Phil Spencer going and saying, I want to make a handheld, what if Nadella went to Spencer and said, you're going to make a handheld for us? What if it was a little flipped on its head?
Yeah, well, when possible. The boss man comes and says you're going to do something, I think we've all worked in a business before. When the boss says do something, it's going to happen.
Got it. Speaking of people saying things are going to happen that may or may not happen, Parris, you had a little bit of a scoops over on that other show, the X-Cast, with Mike, yourself, and Mr. Jeff Grubb, I believe, was on there also. And Jeff Grubb said that Gear 6 is coming. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this thing that's happening?
Yeah, so we were speculating about what may be shown this June, and then the conversation kind of turned towards Gears. And, you know, I was like, I could see them potentially teasing it. You know, we won't get it this year or anything. My thought is, again, if next gen is truly holiday 2026, Gear 6 would make a lot of sense to be a launch title on that, to really showcase Unreal 5, you know, for the next generation. So then Grubb chimed in and goes, you know, I haven't told anyone this yet, but people that he'd been talking to heard that it might, keyword, might be seen this summer, which makes a lot of sense if it does happen. And that'd be great to see. I mean, I do think it's time that we get some more information on Gears. And Destin, I actually saw one of your videos going back to a tweet that I had made during GDC, mm-hmm. when we saw the 1943 game, you know, with Captain America and Black Panther
running
on Unreal 5. Yeah, looked fantastic, which made me tweet. I go, if this looks that good, imagine what Gear 6 is going to look like on Unreal 5. And then somebody from the coalition actually responded and just said, yep, which, you know, sparked a bunch of stuff. And I do believe he deleted that at point.
But, sorry, Colin.
Yeah. But I mean, it just really comes down to this. I mean, we know we're going to get a Gear 6. It's probably the worst kept secret ever at this point. So being able to get a tease of it this year, I think would be exciting. And, you know, Shinobi Online, you know, he obviously puts out a lot of stuff on social media. He mm-hmm. even said, we're not ready yet for whatever Gear 6 is going to look like on Unreal 5. And again, when we see a Hellblade 2, when we see a 1943, it gets me excited to see what the Coalition is going to be able to do in Unreal 5, because outside of Epic themselves, they're probably the best in the industry from a visual standpoint. So it's exciting. I really do hope we get a tease this year.
So Colin Penty, he's not like a guy. He is the technical art director at the Coalition. Yeah. He helped build the Matrix demo. Or he helped work on the Matrix demo, which was an early technical showcase that was released on both PlayStation and Xbox, and has done a tremendous amount of work with the Unreal Engine to help all of the games industry make games better. They also had like a technical demo a few years back where they were just showing all of the different bells and whistles that the Unreal Engine has. And I was very excited to hear him say three-letter word, yup. That has me really hyped. What's your take on this Unreal Engine 5 stuff, Brad? Because we just saw the Hellblade news. It's glowing. Yeah. People are saying it's fantastic. What do you think?
I was about to point out the Hellblade is going to be, that is going to be such an interesting title from, I think, the exact perspective you just nailed it on, right? I think I'm definitely going to be playing it just to see like how far were they able to push this on what we consider current generation hardware. Is it really as good, right? We all know the experience of, hey, we watched the game trailer. It looks amazing. And then you get in there and it's like, it's not quite it. Mm-hmm. I think that is really going to be sort of the emphasis here, because whatever they're capable of doing here, we know that it's like, hey, they're in the Xbox community. They're in the Xbox studio world. Like they can walk down the street proverbially and help the other studios do the same thing. So depending on how far they can push this, I think we'll really foretell about what we can expect to see from other studios bringing content to Xbox.
Yeah, that's honestly, between us, that's what has me the most excited. It's one studio doing something so incredible with Unreal Engine 5 that it pushes the whole industry forward. It teaches everybody what the engine is capable of and what you're able to create within that engine. And that is really, really exciting for me. Another thing I'm really passionate about is game preservation. And in that same Windows Central article, Sarah Bond let it slip via Jez Corden that they are building a game preservation team. The full quote is, "We have formed a new team dedicated to game preservation, important to all of us at Xbox and the industry itself," Bond said. "We are building on our strong history of delivering backwards compatibility to our players, and we remain committed to bringing forward the amazing library of Xbox games for future generations of players to enjoy." Now, Xbox is probably one of the most dedicated to game preservation. They started this initiative back with the Xbox One. I believe it was around 2017. They talked about their initiative with backwards compatibility, and they have repeatedly reinforced that idea. They did it when the Xbox One X and S launched. And I am very, very excited to hear that they are actually dedicating an entire team to this idea. Brad, what are your thoughts about this news? Because obviously I'm stoked.
So I'm very curious if this is related to next gen stuff that we've been hearing about, because first off, the timing feels a little odd, right? It's not like the consoles launched yesterday at this point. And so here we are, we're learning like, hey, they're going to preserve games. And like, what does that mean? Like, to me, that means there's a team who's going to be dedicated or tasked or chartered or whatever you want to call it and say, look, here's this back catalog that we brought all the way forward to the Xbox Series X and S. And certain things had to be done. And so when the next generation comes out, those games are going to have to be adapted in some capacity, right, to be able to run on quote unquote new hardware and or handheld hardware potentially. And so that's what this team is going to do. They're going to pick up a title. It doesn't matter what title, pick your favorite backwards compatible title. They're going to inject the API calls or whatever it is. So then it now works on the new hardware. And so I think this is Microsoft really saying like, look, we're going to continue that backwards compatibility onto the next generation. And they're starting that work today. We're probably a little bit ago. They're now talking about it today.
Mm-hmm. Well, not even really. I mean, that's leaked basically, right? So Parris, what's your take on this?
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. And it was Kareem Chaudhry. It was his team that started that backwards compatibility initiative with the Xbox One. But to the point of what Brad is saying, yeah, I think this is more of a sign towards them looking ahead to next gen and their backwards compatibility plans for next gen and the game preservation, because they even talked about that during the business update as well, because we're kicking and screaming, going into an all digital future. It's just simply going to happen. Mm-hmm. So now that we have these digital libraries, I think people are going to need some reassurances that their legacy libraries are going to be able to follow them on this new hardware. So if Xbox is already working on that to ensure that, that's a great sign. And I will spin it back again into the handheld. This is why I think the handheld is probably more of a next gen thing, because if it is truly going to be, I'm talking about whatever Microsoft would deliver, if it is truly going to be an Xbox handheld, that is a console that you can take on the go and then dock it to your television, it's going to need to emulate the entire experience. You can't say, well, the console that only connects to my TV can do full backwards compatibility. People that go buy whatever that handheld would be would probably have that same expectation for their digital libraries as well. So it makes sense. And the fact that they're dedicating a team to that tells me that they're pretty serious about it. So look forward to more information on it.
Yeah, the one game that I hope gets the most love is Fallout 3. So that's my pitch.
I actually meant to bring that up because I've been playing Fallout 3 because of the show. It made me jump back in. And mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been able to pull it up. Had my save from like 2011 there that I could still play. And yeah, it was seamless. It was great.
Yeah, the thing that's crazy about Fallout 3 is if you have a digital or a physical version of that and you have an Xbox Series X, you can just pick up and play. And it has a lot of enhancements already. That was one of the best things about the launch of these new consoles. It was, for me, the fact that they said, hey, we're going to do all these optimizations for these old games. This might have actually even been as far back as when the Xbox One X launched. And it's all just part of the deal. You just get all of this cool stuff at no additional cost. Well, one of my criticisms for PlayStation was they would do director's cuts where they would charge 10 extra bucks basically for some of the enhancements that you get with those games. And of course, you know, added controller support while Xbox was doing it for free. Brad, have you gotten to go back and play any of these old games? What has been your impression after seeing what Microsoft did with the tech?
So part of it, I think, is important to understand what my gaming rotation consists of. So I've definitely played older games. I mean, that's absolutely a fact. I mean, Game Pass has actually opened up a lot of doors from just trying different mm-hmm. titles. But I think if you looked at my play time, we'll just say for 2024, top two may not be the top one, but I would say number two is actually Age of Empires 2. That is that I play that on the console several times a week and I get my butt kicked all the time. But to me, like, that game honestly probably keeps me in Game Pass the most, more than anything else, because it was like my childhood to some capacity. It's like I can just sit down, I can play the computer in a skirmish, I can be whatever team I want, I can, you know, two enemies, four enemies, however I want to go against. And them bringing that forward to the console generation was a huge home run.
So you like it?
Oh yeah, God yeah, yeah. There's no way I couldn't like it. I mean, get to play all your old games. That there it is, right on the screen, man. That is too many hours into that game, but I enjoy every second of it.
I thought he wasn't even going to play it. He's like, it's an RTS. I'm out.
Oh, it's so good. It's so good.
You know, on that note, you talked about your game time. One of the things that Bond also discussed was black hole titles. She also highlighted that at a time when the gaming industry's growth is flattening, ours continues. But she referenced some of these games that are taking up a lot of the industry's time, like the entire industry is playing Fortnite, Call of Duty, Minecraft, Roblox. And it seems like players are increasingly reluctant to try anything new, via the article. And the console market has not really grown. You know, Phil Spencer has talked about how they lost the console war during the Xbox One era, but that market's not getting bigger. The PS2 sold 160 million units and nothing has really surpassed that since. So do you think that we're going to see some substantial changes with what the industry decides to do going forward, beyond hardware, beyond software, but the whole shebang? Do you think we're going to see some surprising changes in the next 5 to 10 years? Parris, what are your thoughts?
You know, it's interesting, like, you're bringing up the black hole games because, you know, you and I both play Destiny a lot. So that was my black hole game for, like, you know, the past decade for sure, where I just was not playing other things. But to your question, clearly something's going to have to change on that. I think even today we just saw a game like the Dead Space remake didn't sell that well. So now that team isn't making the Dead Space 2 remake. They're moving on to something else. It's coming down to, you need games that can have a long shelf life, that are getting people to continue to engage with. This is why Fortnite is just such a monster right now, because people are willingly giving their time and their money to that game month after month, year after year. So do I want nothing but live service games? Of course not, because I think that we've seen that those, you only have so many that can be successful, again, because of the time commitment.
Suicide Squad, Anthem, like examples of games that have not been successful for the companies that made
them. Right. Exactly. And I mean, look, we all love our AAA games. We love these big budget games, but I think the budgets have just simply gotten out of control. And here we are right now because they're not getting that return on investment. I think if anything, we're going to start to see teams get smaller, game sizes as well get smaller, so that budgets get smaller, so that these games can be more viable. And I think Xbox approach is, okay, if the console market is not growing, which they've repeatedly told us now here over the past couple of years, then where else can we find growth? This is why this is probably why they acquired Activision King, because they can leverage into the mobile market. And again, getting their games onto as many screens as you possibly can, you're going to get more people willing to at least try it, which I think, again, this is why Game Pass is a thing, where someone can try more games and find something that, you know, appeals to them, versus having to spend $70 up front and then finding out this is simply not something that they want to play and they're not going to invest their time into.
Brad, what do you think? Are we as an industry seeing a bit of a saturation point and need to evolve, so to speak?
It's a really interesting question, because there's two ways you have to look at gaming. Some people look at it as pure entertainment, right? I'm going to sit down, I'm going to play Age of Empires 2 by myself, and that's going to be my thing. However, as I've gotten older, I've appreciated this more. It's also, in my mind, a bit more of a social thing, right? Like, I sit down and I play Call of Duty Warzone with the same group of guys that I have for probably 15 years. Mm-hmm. And so, like, depending on where you're at and what you're targeting is going to produce a different result. A lot of people also kind of forget, too, that live services games don't always start as live service games. Remember, Call of Duty was never a live service game. It started as a classic game. And to Paris's point, I think we learned during the acquisition that a single Call of Duty title is something like $300 million. Which is an absurd amount of money for a company that's not established like Activision to go try to spend and build a game. I mean, that is a career-defining shift to say, all right, I need to raise $300 million to try to build a live service game such as Anthem. You know, we could use that. We don't know how much it costs. Mm-hmm. And then to not have it work out. And so I think we will kind of see these smaller games start popping up. I think Baldur's Gate 3 is a fantastic example of you don't have to be an Activision to find success. You just need a quality, polished experience, and then you can break into the market. I'm really curious to see how Baldur's Gate 3 actually evolves, right? They caught lightning in a bottle. Now what do they do with it, right? We've seen other companies catch lightning in a bottle, and sometimes it works out, sometimes it doesn't. But I don't think we're going to see a stagnation. I think there's a lot of good studios out there doing wonderful things, taking risks. But the reality of it's business at the end of the day, that not all of them will make it and not all of them will survive. And we've definitely seen some contraction in the market, right? Remember during the pandemic, everything was like, everything's going to be a service and a game and whatever. So they all got split up or bought up, I should say. And now we're coming back into like, what does a normal gaming cycle look like? And so I'm curious to see how Microsoft does with its effectively unlimited resources now and this huge budgets. What are they going to do versus what are these independent studios going to try to do to make themselves stand out at the end of the day?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting time because some of the biggest successes we're seeing are Baldur's Gate 3, as you mentioned, and Larian has said they're kind of wrapping up on Baldur's Gate 3 and they're going to do something totally different for their next game. I'm very excited to see what that is. But in addition to Baldur's Gate, there's Helldivers, there's Palworld, and I know it's a bigger publisher, but Capcom's Dragon's Dogma 2 kind of, you know, took the internet by storm there the last few weeks. So, I do think that AAA has been for too long just chasing a trend like the live service trend, and it hasn't been panning out for them because at the heart of a project should be about, you know, developing just an amazing game. And I do worry that like with like what was Suicide Squad, it was just such a bizarre combination of things that didn't really fit well together. It's like you put Rocksteady on a live service game and like the combat's good, but it's not great. And you have this, you have the winning formula. You have the Shadow of Mordor Nemesis system. You have the Batman license. They concepted that already with the leaked Batman game that we found out about not that long ago. So anyway, sorry, I'm just going, that's a little bit tangenty. Let's move on to something a little bit different here. I had a question for you, Brad. There's been a lot of talk about Xbox AI and the AI buddy assistant. Parris, I know you work in computers, so maybe you'll know more about this than I do. Why should I care about this AI stuff? Brad, maybe you start.
So I think we'll see it come in multiple flavors over time, right? I don't think if anybody's expecting they're going to boot up an AI, the quote unquote first AI game at the end of the day, and it's going to be some dramatically different experience, I think that's going to be a bit of a letdown. I think we're going to see this become progressive. So one of the things that's happening in the industry right now are these things called NPUs that are supposed to help elevate and accelerate the AI workloads. And so when Sarah Bond, I think in that same memo or that same meeting, was talking about a generational leap and that sort of stuff, I really think that they're going to be putting an NPU in the next piece of hardware that comes out of Xbox. I think that's probably a given, honestly. I'd be shocked if they don't. And what I would expect to see is actually more realistic engagements with NPCs, right? We all know the experience, like you walk up to the random guy and you hit a thing and you get like one of five voice lines or some random static thing. But with these large language models or learning models and these NPUs that are going to be localized, I think we'll start to see those experiences become much more richer and fulfilling, and they'll actually feel more like an ecosystem, or I should say a society, if you will, like if you're thinking like GTA 6 as a wild example, where every character actually truly has a personality rather than just a scripted piece of text that they might regurgitate at some point.
Parris?
To try and put this in simpler terms, not to get super technical on this, I actually sat in on a talk, an AI talk that Xbox had during DICE this year, talking specifically about this. And the way it was presented is they want to be able to use AI to help speed up the development process to make it more efficient, you know, better workflows, et cetera, because Matt Booty has even talked about this in the past. We're seeing these big AAA games. The development cycle is just getting bigger and longer, you know, all the time. So we're waiting. We get a game announcement like Perfect Dark was announced in what, 2020. We're still waiting. Hellblade was in 2019 and we're just now getting it as examples. So that's one way, but everything Brad was talking about, I 100% believe, yeah, that AI is going to be a part of whatever this next generation strategy is going to be for Xbox with their next hardware. But my only real concern about this, and this was a part of that talk as well, is this going to actually eliminate jobs? And, you know, we're obviously already going through layoffs in the industry as it is. But as these teams get smaller and you're starting to supplement some of that work with AI, what does that mean for current people that are in industry right now that are working on these development teams? So it's kind of a double-edged sword, whereas, sure, AI is going to be able to help game development. That's great. Like you were talking about NPCs, things like that. Fantastic. But is that going to actually take work away from people at the same time? So for sure, we need more discussions on this, need to hear more about how that's going to affect game development.
That's a valid concern. You know, the concern about people losing their jobs, obviously, is always concerning to hear. But to look at it from a more positive light, I do have to wonder if this could basically eliminate crunch or reduce it greatly,
right?
Because that has been an industry issue that has been ongoing for a long time. It's like there is so much work to do, people have to do extra hours to get the work done, What if AI comes in and reduces that workload so they can focus on the things that they're doing really, really well and end up having a healthier work-life balance? I think that could be a positive, but I do see your obviously very valid concern about the use of it. Brad, there's the AI chatbot. Also, I wanted to ask you a bit about that, or we can start with Parris maybe this time. Parris, so there was that. I so don't care about the AI chatbot. I just thought about Clippy 2.0, and it's like another thing. I'm like, why do I care as a consumer about this? So what were your thoughts on it, Parris?
Hey, I mean, I'm with you. It wasn't something like, oh man, this is really going to help me, you know, when I'm gaming. But it made me ask the question, like, who actually is using support and would take advantage of that? There's going to be some use cases for it, of course. So I understand why they're doing this. I just wonder how practical it truly is going to be to have this, what is it, Xbox support is what they were talking about in the scenario. I just wonder how many people are actually going to use it.
Brad, is it like Clippy 2.0?
It's funny. I've actually worn the Clippy suit. There's images of me floating around with it somewhere whenever somebody says Clippy. But this support bot that we're hearing about was 100% developed by Microsoft/Xbox to try to reduce inbounds for support, right? They're like, oh, if we put a chat bot out there and it can do whatever things, refunds were rumored, look up things contextually, if that can reduce tickets for our support staff by 1%, the investment was worth it. So it's worth taking the shot of just putting this thing out there and just seeing what happens. It's not going to be the next great Xbox experience. This is very much an internally driven, motivated bot.
Anytime I message something and I know it's a bot, I'm immediately mad. Like, I immediately hate the thing that I'm talking to. I'm like, just let me talk to a human. So the last few weeks, both of y'all are online. We see the Twitter discourse, and it has been pretty negative basically since the announcement that some of the Xbox titles are going to other platforms. I was curious to get a temperature check from both of y'all and just hear from you about what you've seen online and whether or not you think that it has gotten better or more positive. Parris, what are your thoughts?
You're trying to get me in trouble, Destin.
No. I'm talking specifically, I know there's a lot of controversial stuff going on right now. I mean, specifically about the Xbox conversations going on.
No, of course. Just kidding. But yeah, I mean, I've seen it. And from the beginning, when the initial rumors started coming out about them experimenting, you know, with Hi-Fi Rush, obviously we know now it's Hi-Fi Rush, Grounded, Pentiment, and Sea of Thieves. I viewed it as kind of the way that Phil explained it during the business update, that, okay, they're going to see what works. These aren't titles that are going to get you to come buy an Xbox, basically, right? But they've kind of reached the end of their shelf life within the ecosystem. Let's put them somewhere else. And obviously, Sea of Thieves is a live service game, so it makes sense to get that on as many platforms as possible. So I understand the concern with it. And that's a lot of what I've seen online, is people just concerned. Are exclusives going to go away? Is there a reason for me to still buy an Xbox? Things like that. I just personally think, and like I've said to people, let's get to that June showcase. Let's see what their presentation is going to be like. They've obviously already told us what's coming in 2024 with Indiana Jones, things like that. But start showing us some of these other games that you're working on, and be definitive in your messaging that these things are day one on Xbox, that they're not coming to PlayStation 5, things like, because even with the Hellblade 2 stuff that we've just seen with previews recently, what is kind of some of the discourse been? Oh, I'll just wait till it comes to PlayStation.
Yeah,
okay. That can't be the conversation moving forward with Xbox titles. So get on that stage in June, be definitive about the games that are coming to Xbox, so that people, you know, don't have to be concerned that, well, what's next? Even though Phil told you during the business update, don't take this as a sign that everything's coming, because it's not. Mm-hmm. People still don't 100% believe that. So I think June could ease a lot of minds if they're more definitive in that showcase.
Yeah, the whole problem with the showcase, though, is Phil Spencer said that this isn't a sign that things are going to start going everywhere, that's not going to happen. But also, we're going to look at the data and see what happens, and we're experimenting. And then he talks to The Verge, and he talks about how, you know, exclusives are basically a way of the past. And it's like, well, wait, so what is it, Phil? Is it there aren't more games coming everywhere? Or is it all this other stuff that you're saying? Because you're
can I say one more thing before Brad goes? Because I definitely want to hear what Brad has to say. But I've heard everything that Phil has said, and I get it from a business standpoint. Of course, you're going to look at the numbers. Of course, in these C-level board meetings, everything is up for consideration. But at the same time, I mean, he's also said they're not going to do anything to hurt the business of Xbox, which I also get. When all this stuff first started, my main thing was, it's like your core titles, your Halos of the world. If that showed up on a PlayStation, that's just weird to me. At that point, I am questioning why you're making hardware. Why are you doing things like that? And they clearly have not done that. And I understand that they're going to look at the numbers and see all that. But if things that have traditionally been Xbox Game Studio games start showing up on other platforms, of course, people are going to question. Of course, people are going to start wondering, why am I investing in your next gen hardware that's going to take the biggest technical leap? That's why I keep saying you got to be definitive about this. I understand Phil's being honest and being transparent about a lot of things that they're doing. But at the same time, you've invested almost $100 billion into this. You're making next gen hardware. You're talking about handhelds. You're doing all these things. I get it. But you have to be respectful to your core audience, which are those console people. That's the reason Xbox has been around for 20 plus years. So if they're not feeling valued, then they're going to start looking at the competition and start wondering, why am I buying your hardware?
Brad, let's hear from you. I just want to say, showing Sea of Thieves as B-roll from our producer, it got me a little riled up when I start thinking that they have PlayStation content exclusives and Xbox content exclusives. Like, are we back in the PS2 era? What are you doing, Phil? You had this with Destiny and you hated it. So why would you do it for Sea of Thieves? Sorry, Brad, I was trying to get a temperature check from y'all about what you've seen online. Brad, how are you thinking the community is doing?
I think the community will be all right. I agree with Parris that Xbox has to come out and be more. The problem is it's gotten them in trouble. They have to be more definitive about their approach, right? They have to come out and say what they're doing. When I say they've gotten in trouble, we all remember, was it 2 E3s ago or whatever, they said these games are launching in the next 12 months. And then like none of them did, or few of them did. And so when they tried to be definitive, they got in trouble. And I think part of that is scary for them to say, like, this game will never go to PlayStation, because of that same model of 2 years from now, they might be like, man, we need some extra money or revenue. Because at the end of the day, they just spent nearly $70 billion to prop up their gaming business. If you think the board of directors is going to let Xbox just get away by just incrementally growing their revenue, that is not how this works. They have to justify that expenditure to themselves and the shareholders. And how are they going to do that? Which is, you know, we've seen these cross-platform titles. That's one way to do it. But I don't think that means everything has to be. But from like a temperature perspective, I think Xbox is going to come out just fine on the other side of this. I think they have to swallow the pill at some point. Right. We've already seen Sony. They're putting games on Steam. Like, this isn't some unusual thing within the industry aside from Nintendo. But I think Xbox will turn the corner. I think it was strategically aligned to come out at a specific time, this information, more so because it's like, look, we'll get this out of the way so then we can start building things back up. Because again, it would have been disastrous for them to say that in, say, September, right before the holiday shopping season. Yeah. They said this in Q1, which is always the slowest time of the year. And so I think it was very strategic, and they have bigger plans and ambitions to grow this thing. And I think Xbox fans, you know, Hellblade 2, the graphics on that, I think, honestly, probably put a lot of people's concerns to bed.
Yeah. No, I agree. Hellblade 2 looks absolutely stunning. I would normally agree with you that Q1 is the slowest, but just some of the games that we've gotten in Q1 have been very impressive. You know, on the Xbox side, you got Dragon's Dogma, which is cross-platform, and you had Pal World, which was a big success. And I've talked about Helldivers. I really like that game a lot. And then, you know, we had, what else? We have Final Fantasy on the PlayStation side, Stellar Blade, and all of this other stuff where there's actually a lot going on in Q1, lot more than expected. Very fair. But to your point, I do think that they did it earlier. I think you're right on that. that they did it earlier to get it out of the way so that they can look forward to June, look forward to May when they're actually going to hit their release cadence, because it's their year. They have a lot of great games coming this year, or at least games that we're excited to talk about.
But I also think that that's part of it when you talk about the temperature of the community and what they're thinking is, we got that developer direct. They got a lot of cool, like, I'm very excited for Indiana Jones to come out. I can't wait to get my hands on that. I think it's going to be fantastic. You look at their second half of the year roadmap. Again, I keep quoting Matt Booty, but I believe he said they basically have about 10 things that are going to be launching this year. And then we look ahead into 2025. So we should all be excited about that. But instead, the conversation has been about these four games going to PlayStation. What does that mean for the future and all of that? So that's where I keep saying maybe June is that time to just ease minds that, look, everything's going to be okay. You know, it's going to be fine. You're going to have a bunch of awesome games to play. This is why you buy an Xbox. This is why you've invested in this ecosystem. And we're assuring you that moving forward, you can continue to do that without worry. That's, in my opinion, what they need to do. You know, like I said, coming up here for that June showcase.
And to bolster both your points, it is an issue of clarity. They need to be very clear and concise about what they're doing, what's exclusive, what not, what the plan is. And I think that's a criticism that could be addressed by being more definitive. Brad, thank you so much for joining us. Parris, thank you so much for joining us also. Brad, I'll start with you. Where's the best place that people can see you, find your stuff, and see your content?
Really, so I've been lucky and I have the same username across everything. It's just BDSAMS. You can find my YouTube channel at that. You can find me on Xbox Live, on Twitter, and everything else. Just BDSAMS.
And Parris?
You can find me over on social media at Vicious696 everywhere. I'm also on Gamertag Radio, and I'm on Kinda Funny.
And you can find me on this website. It's IGN.com. I need to fanboy out for just a second. Believe it or not, I brought back an old show randomly, Fireteam Chat, because the Final Shape gameplay reveal was so freaking hype that I just had to talk about it with some old friends. So Fran was there with me and Ty Guy Travis was there with me. So if you're interested at all in anything related to Destiny 2, catch our reaction there. We also put together a little feature where we talked about all of the new stuff coming in Destiny 2, the Final Shape. So check that out. And of course, you can always find me across all the IGN channels that exist. Thanks so much for watching, everybody. I really appreciate you. So until we'll see you next time. I don't know what the unlocked outro is. Bye, everybody. Well.